Me, I never even planned that one, but that's all right. I said Holy Spirit take over the service, right? Watch out, here we go. Good morning, everybody. Good? All right, let me get set up over here. We'd like to welcome those first-time visitors today. I met a lot of you outside. Can you just help them feel welcome this way? I'm not gonna ask you to raise your hand or anything. Shame, man, sometimes. But no need to be shame. Because this family. Amen. Yeah? It takes about one good 30 seconds before you come family. Yeah? In this place. Anything, Greta? All right. Well, we'll be continuing in our sermon series called Break the Funk. Now, if you've been tracking with us for the last, this is the seventh week already. The seventh week. If you've been tracking with us, God has been doing some unbelievable things in my life. Because I've been trying to, what do they say? Practice what I preach. So I've been trying to allow God to take over through these studies and through this. And when I say that what God wants you to do is crack yourself open and to look at all the good stuff and the bad stuff, that's what I've been doing. And you know what? It's been a challenging thing because sometimes you look into yourself and you don't like what you see. Amen? But we gotta look at them. Yeah, you gotta look at them. You cannot turn away like this. You have to look at it. The reason why we have to look at it is so we can recognize it, so we can tell God to take it away from us. Amen. And that's kind of been the whole premise of this sermon series called Break the Funk. So I hope your funk has been breaking. Amen. Mine went break so hard my hair fell off. So last week, if you were here, last week's principle was about, to me, one of the foundational practices of a believer in Christ. And this one, last week, was heavy. But it had to be heavy, because we need to know the weight and the importance of forgiveness. Receiving it, as well as giving it. We also talked about understanding His grace, and the big one was making amends. Mean though. Now, I don't know if you take notes, or I don't know if you try to put some of this into practice, but all I can say is that my list came long, boy. And I had to reach out and I had to dig deep and really release a lot of things. And a big part too, on my part, is to really understand God's forgiveness and truly receive it. And not beat myself up so much. How many of you are relating with what I'm saying right now? Hallelujah. At one degree or another, we all experience unforgiveness. Whether it's against us or it's within us. But God wants us to be free. Amen? So just to review real quick. We talked about two of the Beatitudes last week. And one of them was Matthew 5:7 that says, happy are the merciful. Then Matthew 5:9 that says, happy are the peacemakers. So we talked about making amends, keeping peace. And also being merciful as God is merciful. Because if we understand His words, His forgiveness is poured out on us as we forgive those who trespass against us. Important. So what is held back if we harbor unforgiveness in our heart? God's fullness. God's fullness is held back because we block it. Not because He doesn't want to give it. We block it with unforgiveness. Unforgiveness, again, is like drinking poison, waiting for another guy to die. Amen? Amen. Stupid. So I gave every week, if you were just, if this is the first time here, every week I give a word, and I use it as an acronym for helpful steps in how to process through this principle we're talking about. So last week, we talked about making amends. So I used the word amends. So real quick, what amends stood for last week was A, admit the hurt and the harm. Sometimes we gotta admit them. Amen? Amends. A, M stands for make a list. That's why I said my list came kind of long. And what it is was I sat down and I made a list of all the people that I hurt that I needed to ask forgiveness from. And then I made a list of people that hurt me. And I prayed over that list. And maybe the list, you know how we are. Somebody's name come to mind and we add to the list. I thought it was power already, God. No, I'm going to add to the list. So make a list, amends. E, encourage one another. Encourage one another. You know, when you ask for forgiveness or you give forgiveness, it has to come from a pure place. It cannot be from a phony baloney place or you just saying sorry because you got caught. It has to come from the purity of preserving relationship and of honoring God. Amen? Because if you cannot come to that place, you better sit before the Lord a little bit more until you can come to that place. And the E stands for encourage one another. We need to do this out of encouraging one another to do what is right before the Lord. Amen? Making amends. E, N. Again, N stands for not for them. Forgiveness is not for them. You give your forgiveness. Yeah? Because that's right. That makes it right between you and God. Now, whatever that person does in reaction is none of your kuleana. Amen. I like that. It's our kuleana to be obedient to God. And if God puts on your heart to go over there and say you forgive them, then you offer your forgiveness to them and you leave it there. And whether they spit in your face or turn away or kick you in the shin or whatever, that's not your kuleana. You just go, hey, I did my part. Your dirty water is between you and God. Yeah? Not to do it resentful, but doing it out of encouragement and love. So N, not for them. It's for you. It's for you. D, do it at the right time. Ask God's timing for this whole asking of forgiveness or even giving forgiveness. Because God has a right time for it. Because if it's the wrong time and it's your time and you like rush them just to check them off your list, you might make the matter worse. How many of you experienced that? If it's not God's time, ask Him what is the good time. And I've seen this work in my life, and I've heard testimonies from other people's lives that when we prayed and asked God to open up the opportunity, He opens the opportunity. And He will. And finally, S in amends is start the process now. Now, we have to wait on God's time, but don't wait longer than God is telling you to wait. Start the process now. Start seeking God. Start cleaning your heart. Start doing a personal inventory to ask God to show you the unforgiveness or the resentments and ask Him to start this forgiveness process in you. And that's what we talked about last week was heavy. Because I think we all have, and no lie, we all have either somebody we gotta forgive or somebody we gotta ask forgiveness for. Amen? We all do. We all do. Okay, so we're gonna move on, and that was our sixth week. Now we rocking now. We're moving into this next level. We only have this week and next week left. And Jesus says in John 8:32, if you live as I tell you to, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So we have been rebuilding. Now, if you've been just practicing this with me from the first week. We have been rebuilding the foundations of our faith through going through these steps here and doing what Christ is asking us to do. And that's the bottom line. And if you've been doing this, you probably have been seeing some change in your life. And if you haven't, you will. If you continue to do what Jesus is asking you to do in His Word and in His will. And as we grow, like anything else, you will come to this place I call the crossroads. Now let me explain. A crossroads is when you've been going down this path and you come to another path that crosses in front of you. You have a choice now to either go left, go right, or go straight. In any element of our life that we're trying to change, whether it be trying to get back into shape, trying to save money, trying to improve your marriage, trying to improve your parenting relationship with your kids, or your spiritual growth, you're going to reach a part in this process that is called the crossroads. Because there's going to be a point, like all of us, and this is because we live in this flesh, it's going to come to the point where we start thinking, oh man, I see some good change in my life. Oh man, I've been experiencing some good victories. And then, oh yeah, this is good. And then before you know it, it becomes, yeah, this is good to tan taran. A little bit of victory can cause a little bit of pride. And a little bit of pride, what the Bible says is pride comes before the fall. So at this point in our sessions, this is week number 7. This is what I call the crossroads. And maybe all of you can relate to this. And I see people in their walk with Christ come to this, where they come to a season where God has been doing some great things, some great turnarounds in their life. But then I see it go left. I see it go left in the form of spiritual pride. Well, you don't need to tell me that. I know that already. I wouldn't read that already. Oh, what? No. Hey, I've been reading this passage for years already. I know what I'm doing. You know what? That's exactly what Satan wants you to think. Yeah. We gotta have the white belt philosophy. We cannot think just because we're graduating from white to, what is it, yellow, then orange, then brown, well, I don't know, that we arriving. We always learning. And though God is doing great things in your life, and though there is breakthroughs and great glory moments in your life, and you've reconciled with your wife, and your kids have come back, and God has granted you a good job, and now, wow, Lord, you've been so good to me. Don't let it turn into, I know everything already. I've been walking with the Lord for 30 years. So this is a crossroads. And today I want to talk about how to keep focused on continuing to grow and celebrate those glories in the context of our growth in Jesus Christ. Amen? 1 Corinthians 10:12 is going to be our main scripture today. And it says this: so if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. 1 Corinthians 10:12. As we go through the next 2 weeks, we start to live out this transformation for the rest of our lives. And that's the point. It's not, it's like when you try to get healthy, you try and plan for the rest of your life. You got to change your lifestyle. You cannot go on an 8-week diet, lose a bunch of weight, and on the 9th week go Rainbow's Drive-In.
There you go.
And then go down the road and go Leonard's after. You got to have a plan before your 8-week diet is up. A plan on how you're going to live out the rest of your life to continue this life of health. You see, I see people in the spirit do this too. You know, they go through a course. We have a course that we offer here called OSL, and I'm going to offer this course again in the near future. And it's a very committed, hardcore four or five weeks of very deep study and sacrificing in your life. And I'll offer that course again. But you know, I've read of people that go through this, and then at the end, just go back. Oh, I can rest now. No, it's not a matter of doing one course and then giving up at the end. If we're not planning out the rest of our life and how we're going to change our lifestyle, then we're not going to continue on this healthy track. And I want all of us to continue on this healthy track. How about you? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So don't feel tantara. Because the enemy will take root. So today's seventh principle, you can write this down or I'll post it on our website if you miss it. Principle 7 is this. Take life. Take lifetime steps to win. Self-inventory, Bible reading, journaling, and prayer to know God and His will for my life. Amen? You know, it says in 1 Thessalonians 1:5, it's not up here, let me read it. It says, "For when we brought you the good news, it was not only with words, but also with power. For the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what we said was true. And you know of our concern for you from the way we lived when we were with you." You see, Paul is talking to the church and he's saying, you know what? You know that we care for you, not by my words, but how I live my life. You see, the bottom line with this is, as we continue this season, we want to all mature in Christ to the point where people see Christ in you through the way you live and not what you say so much. Amen?
Amen.
This is the goal for this whole thing we're doing. That our prayer will be that all of us will mature in Christ so much, and like Paul says, that people will know that you care for them, not by what we say, but how we conduct ourselves. Because they see Jesus in the way we speak. They see Jesus in the way we love. They see Jesus even in the way we drive. Oh, Lord, help me. They see Jesus in the way we greet others. Sunday morning. Or during the week. Or how we talk to irritating people who call us on the phone. Or customers. Or guests that come to your job. We want to be Christ to everyone. Christ-like. I mean, I'm not saying you Christ. Got to be careful what I say. People might think that the wrong ways. We want to exhibit Christ in our behavior. That's the bottom line. There's an ongoing tracking with Jesus that we must develop. A practice in the Word every day. And the best, another point to this is how do we do this? We got to be in the Word, and I'll give us some pointers in just a little bit. But we want to come to that place where we're in His Word because we want to. Because our love for Him and our desire to grow in Him is so great that we look forward to cracking open the Word every day to feed. We want to get to that place. I want to get to that place where I can admit when I'm wrong, right when it's made, when I'm aware of it. I want to get to that point where I can ask for forgiveness right away. I guarantee you I'm going to sleep better if I can get to that point. Every day, we need to look over our day. We need to meditate on what we've done during the day. And look at our day and go, okay, what were the things that pleased God? What were my actions? What were my behaviors today? What were the things that I acted out of fear or anger today? We got to get to that point where we can really take a sober look at our lives at the end of each day. We need to keep in shape, amen? Not let ourselves go. We need the tools to keep walking in the victory after this sermon series or after we leave church. The biggest thing is not to relapse. Everybody say relapse.
Relapse.
All right.
No.
Relapse is often used in addictions, amen? In drug addiction, alcohol addiction, any kind of addiction, they always warn you about relapse. Do you know that spiritually we can relapse? Oh yeah. If we're not aware, we can spiritually relapse. Back in the day, they used to call them backslide. I wasn't fond of that term, honestly. Backslide. Oh, you in backslide, huh? Who are you, backsliding Christian, eh? Shut up. That's what my flesh likes say when I hear that. Who are you, backsliding Christian, eh? Shut up. Look in the mirror. But we need to get to that point where we don't backslide or we don't relapse. I don't want to see you backslide. I don't want to see you relapse. So this is how we're going to do it. Today's word is relapse. You guys ready? R. You ready for R? Reserve. And these are all tools we're going to use. Take them or leave them. If you take them, the better chance you're not going to relapse. You don't take them, I'm going to be praying. R. Reserve a daily quiet time. This is tough. But when you put it in perspective, it's not tough. Because if this means your spiritual health, then it needs to climb up on your priority list. I make time to go work. I make time to go out. I make time to go to the gym. I make time to take a nap. You gotta make time to spend with God. Reserve a daily quiet time. It's vital. And you know, I'm finding even more so now that it's so vital for me. The best way to succeed in our walk is to spend time with the Father in His Word, in prayer, and in reflection. I'm gonna challenge you. If you don't do this on a regular basis, try Monday through Friday this week. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Try them. Try. I mean, I'm talking 15, 20 minutes. If you got to just go 15, 20 minutes, but spend it alone with God in prayer, open His Word, and reflection, and see if your life doesn't change this week. I challenge you to do that. If you think you don't have the time, you go, Pastor, I don't have time. I work 3 jobs. I get 4 kids, and I got to... You know what I say? Blah, 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 blah. I'll give you the Charlie Brown teacher right now. Womp, 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 womp. You gotta make time. Make time. R, reserve a daily quiet time. Mark 14:38 says this. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Make time, because the flesh is weak. R, reserve a daily quiet time. E, stands for evaluate. When you evaluate, and your evaluation has to include this, you gotta evaluate, and I'm trying not to go like a psychiatrist here, but because I'm not. All I know is God, and all I know is His Word. But let me tell you this. I know God wants us to evaluate every element of our life. Now check this out. He wants us to evaluate our physical, our emotional, our relational, and our spiritual life. All of them. See, the problem is, I think we evaluate only a few of those, what is it? One, two, four? Okay, physical, emotional, relational, spiritual. Okay, four. Maybe we evaluate our spiritual life, which probably bleeds over to our relational life, which is good. But I don't think we spend enough time evaluating our emotional life or our physical life. I'm learning that God wants us to evaluate all four parts of our life, not just the spiritual. All four. So let me repeat that again. He wants us to evaluate our physical, our emotional, our relational, and our spiritual health. I'm going to get tricky today. I'm going to give you an acronym within the acronym. So when you want to evaluate yourself, you need a heart check. You ready? This is your heart check. Every day, you check your heart. H, am I hurting? Am I exhausted? Am I angry? Am I resentful? And am I tense? And if you answer yes to each one, you gotta figure out why. Quiet inside you. I flunked this test. Am I hurting? Am I exhausted? Am I angry? Sorry, someone came on. Am I resentful? Am I tense? Yes, 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 and yes. But why? Ask God why. When we do an evaluation and a heart check, that's all we got to ask ourselves. And God will reveal to you why. Then when it's revealed, then we can start asking Him to try and fix it. Not try, He will. He can. Amen? Now let me read for you this scripture that really relates to this heart check. Now, it's a long one, so I didn't put the whole thing up there. I just put little segments. So I'm going to read it. And just some of these verses will flash on the screen, but listen to these words from Romans 12. When you evaluate yourself, read this scripture, Romans 12, 3-17, and it goes like this. Here we go. Because of the privilege and the authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. This is Paul writing to the church in Rome. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. Just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other. In His grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Don't just pretend to love others. really love them, the word says. Then it says this, hate what is wrong, hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Verse 11, never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Verse 12, rejoice in our confident hope. And then this one, be patient in trouble and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep. Verse 16, live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people.
Go, Paul.
This is Paul. This is God talking. And don't think you know it all. Verse 17, never pay back evil with more evil. And then finally, do things in such a way that everyone can see you're honorable. Whenever you need to evaluate yourself, read that. Whenever you do a heart check, read that. I read that and go, wow, Lord, help me in a lot of my areas. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. So evaluate. Okay? So we're using the word relapse. R-E-L. L stands for listen to Jesus. It's a simple one. Listen to Jesus. Quiet yourself long enough to listen to your bodies and your mind and your souls. We need to hear the Lord's direction. But we get so busy and we get so many voices in here. And I'm not talking about, you know, just craziness. I'm talking about there's so many thoughts that go through our mind. Like, what I got to do tomorrow? What I have to do for my kids? What do I have to do for church? You know, then you start going through the task list in your mind. And our mind is so busy that we forget to shut it down so we can hear what God is saying. Listen to Jesus. We live by a philosophy here at this church called Ho'olohepono. Listen intently and righteously. Listen to God. Shut up and listen to God. Okay. 1 Thessalonians 5:21 says this, test everything that is said to be sure, test everything that is said to be sure it is true. And if it is, then accept it. Test everything with the Spirit and with God's Word. Galatians 6:4 says, let everyone be sure that he is doing his very best, for then he will have the personal satisfaction of work well done and won't need to compare himself with someone else. Isaiah 1:10, listen to the Lord. Hear what he is telling you. So we need to listen to Jesus. Quiet our minds. Listen to Jesus. Okay? The A in relapse. Okay, we're moving on. Letter A. Alone with and quiet time. Now, this is a little bit different than what I talked about before. We need to be alone and quiet. What I'm talking about now is that time Jesus spent alone with his Father. We need to do the same. We need to set a daily appointment to be alone with God, to listen carefully, to learn how to hear God. And you know, it's almost the same thing. We need to be alone sometimes. See, there's a difference between isolation and solitude. Did you know that? When we isolate ourselves, that means we're running away. But when we seek solitude, we are seeking alone time with our God. We are making still ourselves so we know that he is God. In fact, there's a scripture that says that, right? Psalms 46:10, be still and know I am God. So relapse. A lot of these things even sound the same, but that's how important these principles are. Amen? The P in relapse. P stands for plug in to God's power through prayer. We need God's guidance. We need God's direction. But it can only start when our demands stop. We got to pray in the right way. Of course, we need to be specific in our prayers. And we need to pray about everything. But we need to pray in this right way where we're not demanding of God like a genie in a lamp. But we're offering ourselves to Him in conversation. And we do a lot more listening than we do talking. And we ask God for His perfect will in our lives. Philippians 4:6 says this: don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. I love that scripture. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God your needs and don't forget to thank Him for His answers. Don't forget to thank Him for His answers. Even if you don't like the answer, thank Him for His answers. Even if His answer is wait, thank Him for His answers. God has three ways to respond to our prayers. Yeah? Yes, no, and wait. For real. That's His answers. He'll go, yeah, go. Or He says, no. No go. Okay. But then He'll go, no, wait. And even if it's not yes, even if it's no or wait, we got to thank Him for His answer. Amen? So plug in to God's power through prayer. Okay, S. Slow down your impatience. Right? That's us though. God, I like them now. Yesterday I wanted them. My need was yesterday. I need them now, God. We can become impatient with God's answers. We want to know everything now. We want to know what's going to happen tomorrow. We have to remember that our timing is flawed, but God's timing is perfect.
Amen.
Amen. So slow down your impatience. Philippians 4:7 says this: if you do this, you will experience God's peace, which is far more wonderful than the human mind can understand. His peace will keep your thoughts and your hearts quiet and at rest as you trust in Christ Jesus. Amen. Slow down your impatience. All right. One more. Yeah. E. Letter E. I'm going to keep this message short because I took you guys way too long last week. But it was important last week. This one is important too. So S, slow down your impatience. Finally, E. Here we go. Enjoy your growth. Enjoy it. Enjoy it. Rejoice and celebrate the small successes along the way. Remember, what we said last week, it's a process. It's a voyage, step by step, from victory to victory. Maintain this attitude of gratitude, gang. This mindset is like spiritual vitamins to your soul. Keep that attitude of gratitude. Share your victories, in fact. Even if they're small victories, share them. Testify. Testify to each other. Because I guarantee you, your growth will encourage others. Amen. Anybody want to testify right now? No? How come you shake your head so fast, even? You the very one. God is doing something good in your life, girl. But testify. Pull somebody on the side and say, hey, this is what God has been doing in my life. Awesome. I just wanted to tell you. Well, if you're not going to testify, I'm going to testify. God is doing awesome things in my life. And I'm loving Him more and more every day. He's helping me grow to love my wife more, my kids more, and even this church more. Not that I can't love this church anymore, but I can. But I am so pleased at what God is doing. It's tough, but God is faithful. Amen?
Right.
Okay,
right.
Amen. Enjoy your growth. 1 Thessalonians 5:16. My tongue's all screwed up this morning. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says this: be joyful always. Pray at all times. Be thankful in all circumstances. This is what God wants from you in your life, in union with Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Whew. Amen. Man, we could have just said that scripture and just that would have been the sermon. If we can just live by this, be joyful always, pray at all times, and be thankful in all circumstances, our life would be good. But we need to be in union. That's what I noticed at the end of this. Union with Christ Jesus. So if you're not joyful all the time, check your union with Christ. If you're not thankful all the time, then you better check your union with Christ. If you're not praying at all time, then that's got come no more union between Christ Jesus. I'll do a whole sermon on that one alone, maybe next time. So, before I end, I'm going to give you 4 tips on how not to relapse. 4 tips. You ready? Pray and read your Bible every day. And don't look at it like homework. Look at it as air. You breathe oxygen. Establish a specific time to have your quiet time. You know, there's a practice that we have called life journaling. If you want to learn that, come and see myself afterwards, and we can teach you how to feed yourself the Word of God. We follow the life journaling reading plan, and we use the SOAP method. You guys know what that is? Let me explain it real quick. Now, this is what I do on a daily basis. I get the daily reading, I read through it, and then I kind of pray on which verse pops out and really speaking to my heart about what I'm going through that day or this season. And I write that verse down. That's the S. Yeah? S, scripture. Write them down. O is observation. So I write another paragraph on, in my own words, what I see God doing in this scripture. In my own words, an observation of what God is doing. S, scripture. O, observation. A, application. Then I write another paragraph on how I believe God wants this scripture to be applied to my life today. Write that down. God is talking to my heart that I need to forgive more because of this scripture today. And P, finally, the P stands for prayer. Just write a short little prayer. Thank you, God, for your forgiveness. Help me to forgive others in the future. Amen. If you just do that little thing every day, you will grow by leaps and bounds, because it will help you spend time with God. It will help you process God's word, and it will help you pray to Him, and He will speak to you through this SOAP. And what does that spell? How many of you bathe every day? How many of you use soap every day? This is soap for your soul. That's right. And the less soap we use, the more dirty we become. If you want more information on how to do this, you can hook up with myself or one of our leaders here. We would love to teach you how to do that more and more. So pray and read your Bible every day. Establish a specific time to have your quiet time. Number 2, make attending church and or midweek group a priority, because we are all in this together. And I tell you something, you are encouraged every time you come here because of everybody else. We are all in this boat together. Amen. We are all in this va'a after the same thing. Yeah, sailing together on this ship. So make it a priority. Plug into church, plug into a small group. Number three, spend time with your family. God gave you that family. Spend time with them. Work on that relationship. Now, in some cases, maybe your family not safe for you. That's a real true story. If you get an abusive spouse that beat you up, no go and spend time with your family. That's when you just spend time with your church family. And we pray for that family. But plug in. Spend time with your family. You know, even good things can pull you away from your family. Even ministry can put a strain on marriages and relationships with kids. I'm learning that the more time I can spend with my family, the more better I am to be a pastor to you. Amen? Amen. Spend time with your family. Number four, get involved in service. We sure would love you to jump in and help in any pot. Whatever your passion is. Your passion is kids, come help the kids. Your passion is music, come play and sing. Your passion is greeting people with big smiles. Greet people with big smiles. Your passion is food, then come help us make the food. Your passion is the Word of God, then help us break the Word of God together with people. One way to keep your walk going healthy is to do these four things. Alone time with God, in prayer and word. Making your church a priority. Spending time with your family a priority. And jumping in and serving God with your gifts. This will keep your walk going till the day we meet Him in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Let's all stand. We're going to pray, and I want to do something special before we leave today. Like every Sunday for this sermon series, I end with a prayer that I would like everyone to repeat, because it's a special prayer that will help us with this principle. So everybody repeat after me as we pray. Dear God, help me set aside all the hassles and noise of this world to focus and listen to you, your voice alone. Help me get to know you better and better. Help me understand your plan for me. Help me to line up my talk with my walk. Thank you for your love, your grace, your forgiveness. Thank you for all of those you have placed in my life. Thank you for my church family. Your will be done, not mine. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a thank offering this morning. All right. Hey, you can be seated now real quick. If I can ask for just a couple more minutes of your time, I want to do something special today. Now, my heart rejoices, but my heart is sad at the same time, because one of our very own is moving to Maui.
That's Leo.
Leo Lani. Leo, can you come? Can we just pray for you, Leo, as a church, before you move to Maui? Leo has been a faithful servant and wonderful family member to our church since we were at New Hope Manoa. Years and years and years. And she's been such a dear sister to many of us. And babe, can you come? Can we get Jan up here? Jesse? See, you're going to have to tell her to come back more often then, Pikake. Shucks. Hey, Mike, can you come and join us in prayer? Come, Leo. We just want to lay hands on you and say thank you for all that you've done. I remember when Leo came.
Leo, honey. There she is.
I, was so happy. She knew some of my family down Waimanalo, and I just felt that she's from the beginning was part of our family, and she contributed so much in what you see now as Voyager Church, even before it was Voyager. So she's going to go off to Maui, and we want to bless her and pray for her. And if you'd like to say anything, yeah.
Thank you for all the help that I got from aunties, the aunties, Auntie Jean, Auntie Greta, Auntie Henrietta. I would miss the church, I would miss my family, but God has a plan for me, I know. And I'm finding such beautiful family friends, and I'm going to miss everybody.
We're going to miss you.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank you. I pray you guys continue to help Pastor. He's a good pastor. Okay. I'm going to miss everybody, but I got to go. I see you guys when I get back.
Yeah. Hopefully you come back often. But just know that you are always going to be our family. I don't care what church you go up there, you're always going to be part of this church. Forever. Okay, Leo? All right. Can everybody extend a hand as we pray? Dear Lord, Father, we pray for your servant, Leo Lani. Father, she's been such a faithful servant to you, God. And despite the challenges and the ups and downs, she remained faithful. Father, use her mightily, God. Father, protect her from head to toe, from the evil one. Father, help her, Father God, to shine the light of Jesus to those that you will put in her path in Maui. I pray for her sister and her ohana in Maui that she's going to go and help and stay with, Father. That, Father, you bring a new freshness to that relationship, God. And Father, that she continues to grow in you, God. Father, you have such a great plan for her. And Father, we have faith and trust in you that this is all part of your plan. Father, help her to visit as often as she can. But Father, mainly cover her, Father God, with your love, with your grace and mercy. Build her up, Father God, as a kohine or a mighty woman warrior for you, God. So, Lord, we will constantly be in prayer for her, and I pray that she also prays for us. Father, once you build family, it is never broken because it is of the Spirit that we are tied together, not by geographical location. So, Father, although she may be there, she will still be part of here, and vice versa. So, Father, we lift you up, and we thank you, God, with a grateful heart for this one. Leo Lani, in Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen.
So we have some makana for you. For ladies. And one bag of goodies from the brand new store called The Blessed Life. Can you help me thank Leo one more time, everybody? Thank you, Leo. Have the worship team come on. Let's all stand, everybody, as we glorify God, as we close this service. We want to remind you to... You don't want to miss out next Sunday. It's the conclusion of our series called Break the Funk. And we got a good message for you. So thank you for joining us today. Thank you all. And I hope you were blessed. And I hope to see you again.